Hello, and welcome to the Paul Mellon Centre. And yeah, just thank you for coming today, despite the heat. And we're really looking forward to the event today. Before I start actually introducing the speakers and so on, I have some sort of housekeeping to do. And actually the first one, which is I'm going to wear my mask. So can you hear me all right? Okay, thank you. So I have some sort of fire safety things that I will just quickly run through. We have no fire drills scheduled for the event today. So if the fire alarm sounds, leave your stuff behind and calmly evacuate the building. The nearest fire exits are on the ground floor through either doors at the center that you would have seen. Just make sure that you you don't leave the area or attempt to return until advised by a member of PMC staff. So that's all for fire safety things. And to properly welcome you now to what is the sixth and final event of our summer evening research seminar series, Liquid Crystal Concrete, The Arts of Postwar Britain, 1945 to 1965. And today's event is titled Postwar Colonialism. And we will be hearing from two speakers, Iain Jackson and Rixt Woudstra. And I think I just wanted to say a few words about the series. And I know some of you have attended either online or in person other events in the series. And you will have noticed that the talks have been quite different. And I think, you know, when we think of the post-war, we do think in a sense of it in relationship to the war and kind of thinking about rebuilding Britain and Europe. And we often think of the empire as something quite separate, something that is more of a 19th century phenomenon, and don't really think of them as coexisting in time or space. So one of the things I was really interested in doing when we were conceptualizing the series is really for us to think about what colonialism or the empire meant in this period, and how, in a sense, discourses around art and design that were happening in the empire, materials that were extracted in the empire, also fed back into art design and sort of architecture here. We have heard some talks about artists migrating, artists and designers migrating here. So we've already started a discussion. I'm really excited to hear two experts speaking about modernist architecture in British West Africa. And Iain Jackson will speak to us especially around attempts of forming a Bauhaus art school in Accra. And Rixt will talk about modern interiors and the United Africa Company in post-war Britain, with a particular focus on timber. So to introduce our two speakers, I'll introduce both speakers now, and then we'll have the two talks, and then I'll come back and we have a sort of discussion and Q&A with the audience and reception afterwards. Okay, so Iain Jackson is an architect and historian at the Liverpool School of Architecture. His research is concerned with late colonial and tropical modern architecture in the Global South and West Africa in particular. He is currently working on a Louvre Hume Trust-funded project to investigate the architecture of the United Africa Company in collaboration with Unilever. This research stemmed from an exhibition and catalog on the mercantile architecture of Accra, co-curated with Archie Africa in 2019. And Rixt Woudstra is a historian of modern architecture and material culture with a specific focus on the effects of British colonialism on the built environment. She's currently an assistant professor at New College of Humanities in London and a postdoctoral research associate at Liverpool University's Department of Architecture. And our two speakers know each other's works, and I think that'll also come through today. In Liverpool, she's a part of the project that I just mentioned. And actually, she is joining the University of Amsterdam as a tenure track assistant professor in the summer of 2022. So basically now. Welcome to Iain and Rixt. So Iain, if you would start, that'd be great.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for coming out on this suitably hot evening, and it's going to fit with the topic in many ways, I suppose. It's a real privilege to be here, and I'm delighted to share some of my research with you today. Ideally, would go now to West Africa, would set off and would go on a trip and explore it, and I would encourage you to do so. We haven't got time this evening, so in this paper I'm going to show you some of the slides from the archive and also some photographs that we've taken recently. In this paper I want to investigate how modern architecture was used in post-war West Africa, both as a nationalist device through state-sponsored projects, but also as a mercantile neo-colonial tool. And I'd like to share some lesser known and also some quite well-known examples of modernist architecture commissioned by large companies, and also to look at how that architecture was presented, published, and used as a means of building an image of a new Africa in the post-war period. There's some extraordinary modern architecture built in the run-up to and immediately after political independence, and it was brought about by a fertile mix of nationalism, economic expansion, education reform, government and commercial investment, and in particular, a drive towards industrial production. Our story starts in World War II, and there was a decision to develop a new school focusing on African crafts, artisans, and techniques that could then inform manufacturing, building components, and products. It was something of a radical proposal and received ample funding from the Colonial Office. The West African colonies were previously envisaged as having only a complementary economic relationship with the UK. But this was a position that became increasingly contrary to the ambitions set out in the Colonial Development and Welfare Acts. And post-war in this sense means, in a way, whilst the conflict was still happening during the war, West Africa was not a theatre of war, and this saw a relatively stable condition for reimagining what might follow. This new school was to be formed within the prestigious and elite Achimota School in Accra. And this department was named the West African Institute of Industries, Arts and Social Sciences. And it was led by a Russian emigre artist called Herbert Vladimir Meyerowitz. And the objective was a marriage of the old aesthetic skill and power to modern technique. West African crafts and industry were surveyed, and a new museum was established to prevent the extinction of interesting and often beautiful construction and designs. The Institute received a major grant of £127,000 in 1943 from the Colonial Development and Welfare Fund to further expand its activities and production. And they created a four-year apprentice and master system. And it had an amazing, enthusiastic subscription, and the staff and students visited artisans across West Africa. It was hoped that the Institute could produce building materials and products and household goods from the campus. And whilst this fascination with craft was quite nostalgic in the face of oncoming technology, it held a certain nationalist appeal and built confidence in West African skill and taste. The Colonial Office sent Henry Morris, the chief education officer for Cambridgeshire, to report on the Institute, and he visited Ghana in 1946. Although the Institute's progress was impacted by the war and loss of key personnel, Morris saw its potential and suggested broadening its remit to become an Institute of Architecture, Planning and Design. Morris had commissioned Walter Gropius and Maxwell Fry to design the Impington Village College near Cambridge, and it was this model he had in mind for West Africa. And in his report, he stated it would be wise to adopt the same ideas of Gropius and to try and establish a Bauhaus in West Africa. Morris noted how architectural education was absent in the West African education reports and didn't feature in either prospectus of the new University of Ibadan in Nigeria or in the Gold Coast colleges. But despite his recommendations, it wasn't to be. The colonies were destined to produce art and crafts, but the act of building, technology and construction was to remain absent, despite this initial enthusiasm. The Colonial Office also lost its enthusiasm for the Institute. They were looking for a much larger scale production based around industrial manufacturing rather than artisan crafts-based design. Whilst the Bauhaus model was not pursued, Impington Village College design was. And Maxwell Fry, together with Jane Drew, were commissioned to design over 20 schools in Ghana, arranged on a similar model to Impington Village College. They produced over 20 designs that were all different, but were really variations on a theme. They had what Fry called a family resemblance to each other. But they were modified versions of Impington. They were modified to adapt to the climate and eventually developed a kind of language of perforated screens, sometimes incorporating local motifs and references, such as the Ashanti stools that you can see at Apukaweri and Prempeh colleges in Kumasi. Beyond formal education, other state-sponsored projects saw the development of libraries, such as this example in Accra, designed by Nixon and Boris in 1951, with artworks by Kofi Antamabam, who had studied with Meyerowitz at the Achimota Institute. Other libraries were built in all of the major towns, including at Sekondi, Kumasi, Koforidua, and Cape Coast, following the New Library Act. And these were nearly all designed by James Cubitt. Education and libraries in particular were treated as major central pieces and focal points in the townscape, including in the development of the new university campuses, such as at Ibadan University in Nigeria. The universities were seen as new utopian microcosms of an ideal society and a prerequisite for a political independence. And the libraries were given special treatment within the campuses as repositories of knowledge and ideas. It was a modernism that was heavily derived from a response to climate, with brise soleil, elevation of the main accommodation on Pilotti, window hoods offering solar protection, and so on. But more than this, it was expressive, incorporating patterns, shadow, decorative motifs, colour, and heavily embellished with murals, reliefs, and sculpture to further augment, decorate, and provide didactic storytelling. Beyond formal education and state-sponsored works, large businesses such as the United Africa Company, or the UAC as it was known, also sponsored and built various projects, such as community centres and assembly halls. Mining companies had previously built similar amenities in remote locations, but in the 1950s there was a much more direct approach, occupying prominent sites and a much more deliberate attempt to be seen and align with changing politics and societal structure, such as the community centre in Ibadan, which also contained the large mosaic mural by Kofi Antamabam. There was the assembly hall at Ibadan University, which was again funded by the UAC. And other companies were equally active, such as the Manganese Mining Company, who built this community centre in Tarkwa. And there were many others sponsored by the large businesses, such as Cadbury's. It was an architecture that was aligned with an urgency for new beginnings and the drive for political independence, and responding to the increasing urbanisation and shifts in society that the industrial drive was largely responsible for. There was a neo-colonial elasticity that stretched into the post-colonial period, and large businesses wanted to retain their power, prestige, and to curry favour in this changing political landscape. But equally, there was also a contribution of modernist architecture to the nationalist agenda. So modernism wasn't a politically neutral solution, no architecture is. And whilst it enabled or masked the neo-colonial continuity that extended beyond political independence, it was also desired and expected by African politicians for its ability to deliver a vision of progress, newness, and a sophisticated now. It was a modernism that was not playing catch up with elsewhere, nor do I see it as an imported pastiche. For architects at that time, they were responding to climate, but not just in a meteorological sense. They were responding to the cultural climate and developing a new lexicon of design innovation. Accra, Kumasi, Lagos, and Ibadan in particular formed a locus or a constellation of centres for progressive, innovative design. And this was stretched between a nationalist drive for change, industrialisation, improved houses, and new cities, and the means by which this was possible through the old mercantile firms and traders, which were headed by the UAC in its raft of subsidiary businesses. The merchants also traded on this thirst for change. They promoted new products and lifestyles that reinforced or became associated with notions of progress and success. So although they seem like two opponents, they had quite a common aim. And it was a aim that was often different from that of the Colonial Office. When newly elected Prime Minister Kwame Nkrumah set about to deliver his ambition, he put forward the Accra Improvement Drive. A new Ghana required a new Accra, and with architecture as a central device in presenting the image of a modern liberated capital. And this was in the 1950s when Ghana was still part of the British Empire, but it had an elected prime minister. And here modernism could be deployed with many motives, intentions and desires. There was a comprehensive remaking and rebuilding to express notions of progress, change, development and industrialization and ambition. For example, guest houses and bungalows were to be replaced with international hotels. Dilapidated train stations were replaced with new highways and car showrooms. Village housing was to be replaced with apartments. Congested harbours were to be replaced with new ports and purpose-built factories. And these were to make new goods that would be branded, new lines of food and beverages. Retail moved from stalls and warehouses to boutiques, and companies like the UAC were well positioned to help fulfill, encourage and manipulate these desires and the ideas of development, success and nation reimagining. Shops such as AG Leventis, UTC and Kingsway stores were able to capitalize on the ambition for a renewed nation. And the idea of modernity and progress through material goods and consumption, with many workers now in paid employment and with a disposable income, having obtained work in the factories. Model houses required furnishing. Car production plants saw new showrooms, and a glamorous lifestyle was created and then vigorously shared and promoted through the department stores such as Kingsway stores and their events such as The Good Life, which promoted and demonstrated everything from clothing, food, home furnishings, cosmetics and travel. There was the Ideal Home Show opened by Nkrumah's wife, a design center exhibition in 1959, and a mock-up of an entire home in one of the shops. The affluent middle-class lifestyle was being sold with increasing emphasis on the growing numbers of African managers, traders, and civil servants. As the Africanization of white-collar work increased, an outlet was required for this Africanization. There needed to be a physical expression of this taking place. Independence was not only to bring about political freedom, it was also to bring about new forms of living. And the UAC, as you can see on the top left, wanted to be at the core of this move. Retail was also used as part of a strategy for replanning new districts and creating desirable neighborhoods. Apapa in Nigeria, initially a port extension, an industrial hub for Lagos, was now rebranded and developed as a fashionable suburb, complete with a Kingsway store of its own. Kwame Nkrumah Avenue was formed in Accra as a new district removed from the old congested center, and it was complete with car showrooms, parks, precincts, and vast retail emporiums. Shops became a sign of status, and the opening of new stores was a celebrated event and even demanded by local leaders and elites. A town without a Kingsway was considered incomplete, lacking, or a backwater. And the forced perspective drawings suggest something far grander than the reality. The marketing went beyond the company brochures and newsletters into popular culture, such as sophisticated and respectable color journals and magazines. One example is the Nigeria magazine. It's beautifully designed with its stunning front cover images. It was positioned as a high-end cultural publication and was published by the federal government of Nigeria as a quarterly arts and culture journal from 1937. It contained articles on crafts, arts, and historical accounts on the development of modern Nigeria, mixed with an intrigue for African art. In a way, it was pursuing much of the agenda of the early attempts at Achimota College in Ghana. Nearly every advertisement in the post-war period was placed by the UAC in the magazine and its subsidiary companies. And the magazine often contained articles on the businesses. It spoke about the mythology of the river trade. It romanticized histories and suggested a polished benevolence. Nigeria's creation, prosperity, and future was intimately enveloped with that of the traders. The culture and identity of West Africa, according to this magazine, was being presented as that of the company. It was indistinguishable. Industry and prosperity and ideas on modern living, including images of the new Kingsway stores, were presented and discussed. The magazine presented industrialization and commerce as the only way to bring about newness and prosperity, whilst at the same time suggesting their legitimacy and authenticity of these businesses through their long association. Cultural connections and ancestral lineage masked the fraught and often violent past. The magazines also included extended articles written by leading architects running practices in the region, as well as including articles on newly qualified and emerging Nigerian architects. It became about positioning modern architecture within a much longer story, and at the same time ensuring it was sufficiently new. It presented a certain contradiction. Other articles focused on cities, such as Kaduna, Onitsha, and often with provocative titles such as Ibadan, the Black Metropolis. Most of the new buildings discussed in the magazine didn't feature in the UK architectural press, but they were very much celebratory, and they were used to promote new projects and ventures, cities and collaborations, and to position West Africa as a place with a strong cultural identity, with technical and artistic vision, and ripe for future investments. So my summary: there was a close connection between the international mercantile activity and the post-colonial nationalist ambition. The nationalist and nation-building agenda was heavily reliant on the presence and continuation of international capital and trading business. The idea of simply starting again was not possible, nor desirable. And whilst the Africanization of business saw certain shifts in personnel, this wasn't matched by changes in the share structure or ownership, but it did result in major shifts in consumer spending patterns and the image or expression of success and modernization. This in turn saw investment into new premises and city planning centered around retail and shopping environments and offices that reflected political aspirations for new beginnings and also to reflect a measure of success. This close, if often unacknowledged, relationship, even partnership, between the new African politics and international trade created a fertile setting for architecture, responding to the technical demands of the climate, but equally it utilized new materials, developed expressive forms, reflected on cultural references, and included sculptural collaboration that resulted in a vast collection of major modernist works. There's now an urgent need for these works, especially in terms of the mercantile architecture, to be documented, examined, and researched. They tell complex, contradictory stories, as well as being invented collaborations from an overlooked crucible of West African creativity and culture. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you to the Paul Mellon Center, and in particular to Sriya and also to Shauna for making the seminar possible, and also for Iain for giving such a wonderful paper. So today I'm going to talk about new research that has come out of a collaborative Leverhulme-funded project at the University of Liverpool, together with Iain Jackson, who you've just heard, but also with Ewan Harrison and Michaela Tenzon. And this is very much research in progress, but this is a very nice opportunity to share and think through some of these ideas with you tonight. So for the past year, what we've done is we've gone through the vast archive of the United Africa Company, so the British trading company that ultimately became Unilever. From West Africa, they extracted palm oil, cocoa, and other raw goods, while trading back a wide range of other finished goods, such as refrigerators, bicycles, textiles. They even had a suitcase factory, you name it. But today, however, I would like to talk about one of those other precious raw commodities: tropical timber, heavy, dark logs of mahogany and other species exported from Ghana and Nigeria back to Britain, where they ended up as floors, paneling, chairs, tables, cabinets, etc. So our project investigates how the modern West African city was the product of mercantile encounters, looking at trading posts, offices, company housing, harbors, factories, etc., all built by the United Africa Company. And you've just seen some of those buildings. But what I'm also interested in is how the company and how these mercantile exchanges also left an impact on modern architecture and material culture in Britain itself. And tonight, I would like to explore one simple question with you. How does focusing on a building material like tropical timber, as opposed to a specific building or a specific architect, and tracing where that building material came from, who was involved in its production, and how it circulated, allow us to tell a different story or different stories about British post-war architecture and design? Oops, too far. So I'm going to argue that it allows us to do two things. First, to see the extent to which the post-war modern, and by that I specifically refer to architecture and design here, was dependent on colonial and neo-colonial networks of extraction and labor. So looking at the provenance of materials and the labor involved in their making, in other words, allows us to read empire even when we don't think it's there. Second, I also think it allows us to rethink the commonly accepted timeline associated with the post-war modern. So we often think of 1945 and then perhaps also of decolonization in the late 50s and early 60s as these moments of radical change, of rupture. And they really shape our thinking of this period. But looking through the lens of materials and looking through the lens of this specific company, what we see is a sense of continuity rather than rupture. So perhaps, and perhaps this is something we can discuss afterwards, perhaps the post-war, looking from the colonies, started a little bit earlier. And perhaps that moment of decolonization wasn't as big of a change, looking at it, at least from the perspective of this specific company. So let's start. In 1960, the new modernist headquarters of the United Africa Company, or UAC, one of the leading British trading businesses extracting palm oil, cocoa, timber, and other raw goods from West Africa since the late 19th century, opened near Blackfriars Bridge in central London. United Africa House, an imposing modernist high-rise, was designed by the British partnership Kenneth Wakeford, Jerram and Harris, and consisted of one main tall block, which we see here, flanked by two lower five-story buildings, one of which you see here on the left. While the structure's gray concrete and glass exterior appeared cold inside, the architects used a strikingly large variety of gleaming dark timbers, radiating, and here I quote, a feeling of warmth unusual in a modern office block, end quote. Indeed, the doors, floors, and paneling, as well as most of the furniture, were made of rich, deep brown, luxurious West African timbers. And here I've added some of the specific species used. So on the left, what we see here is the entry hall, which used West African or African walnut paneling. Okay. So African walnut paneling. And on the right, we see one of the, or the chairman's office, which had beautiful block guerrilla floors, African walnut furniture, as well as these red, yellow sapele doors. The most expensive varieties, such as deep brown figured African mahogany, were reserved for the top floor boardrooms and the director's dining suite, which we see here on the left, while secretary's furniture was manufactured of cheaper veneers, like we see here on the right. So we see African mahogany plywood, so just a very thin layer. More than just a loose reference to West Africa, the timber in United Africa House served as an advertisement for one of the company's most lucrative subsidiaries, the African Timber and Plywood Company. So what were once stately trees standing tall in dense, remote and humid forests in the Niger Delta and Western Ghana had become smooth, polished office chairs, parquet floors, and cocktail cabinets, transformed through the cheap labor of thousands of local West African workers, like we see here on the left, and we see them floating some of the logs down the river. Although United Africa House, the building no longer exists, is an exceptional example, it was certainly not the only structure containing exotic West African wood in post-war Britain. As I will show tonight, tropical timber from colonial and subsequently independent Ghana and Nigeria was widely used in offices, private homes, but especially in many building projects associated with Britain's emerging welfare state. Post-war Britain, with its bomb damaged cityscapes, has often been described and depicted as a grey nation. And the color gray definitely dominated the recent post-war modern exhibition at the Barbican. Yet if post-war Britain was a country clouded in a never disappearing gray fog, as art historian Linda Mead so eloquently captured in her book, The Tiger in the Smoke, then tropical timbers, I would suggest, added a warm glow, a polished shine, and a hint of color to the new modern brick, concrete, and steel buildings that would come to dominate the post-war city. So the timber used for United Africa House, and as we will see in many other British projects, came from two locations. Sapele, located in the Niger Delta, which is the white dot you see there on your right, and Samerboy, close to the Ivory Coast border in Western Ghana, which is the dot we see here on the left. And the other red dots are all locations throughout West Africa that the United Africa Company had business in. So you can start to see how vast of a network this actually was. Starting in the 1930s in British Nigeria, the company had quickly managed to obtain a monopoly position by systematically buying out local African merchants and smaller British firms while taking out cheap leases, often under questionable circumstances, on vast amounts of forest territory. When United Africa House opened in 1960, both locations, Sapele and Samerboy, had grown into two of the largest industrial timber operations in West Africa, which shipped thousands of sawn planks and sheets of plywood to Britain per year. Oriented around a substantial factory site, they'd evolved into proper company towns, which in turn were connected to a vast infrastructural apparatus of roads and rivers that allowed for the timber to be logged, processed, sawn, and shipped back to Britain. So here on the right on the photograph, you see the factory site in Sapele, Nigeria. We can also see that on the drawing here on the left. And then some of the little dots around that were British bungalows, so for managers, etc. Then when we go back to the photograph and you look farther into the distance, you can actually see that it had grown into quite a town, so that's all workers' housing. And in both of these cities or towns together, about 15,000 people lived. So it was really quite substantial. While shipping timber and plywood to be used in Britain's construction and furniture industry, the buildings in Sapele and Samerboy themselves were made of materials brought over from Britain. The factory buildings and the sawn plywood mill, for example, which we see here, were large sheds that consisted of imported prefabricated steel systems. So these were steel systems that were originally developed by an engineer named Ove Arup, still company Arup, who developed it for emergency housing after the war in Britain. Here it's obviously scaled up, but these were sheds that were very easy to construct and thus cheap. And you can see also on the right how vast of a complex this was. This is what it looks like today. The prefabricated steel structure is still there. We visited 2 weeks ago. It's still in use as a timber factory, different company. But yeah, you can also see how what a vast operation this is. The housing for British managers built away from the factory site, separated by a golf course, which is also still there, loosely situated in the tropical forest, consisted of concrete, again brought over from Britain, as well as metal window frames, also imported. And so when we visited, we actually had to stay in one of these bungalows, the bungalow there on the right, which was quite an adventure. So we did some proper embedded history. And you can see those imported metal window frames here on the right as well. Yet while the timber and plywood produced by the company contributed, as we will see, to the making of British post-war modernism, The houses in Samarboy, also built in the 1940s and 50s, seem to look backward in time instead of forward, perpetuating the old-fashioned traditional idea of the colonial bungalow. Although these bungalows, factories, and workers' housing may not be considered remarkable or monumental architecture, and have therefore been left out of most, actually all, histories of colonial architecture, taken together, they form the physical and economic infrastructure that contributed to the making of British postwar modernism. The success of the company was closely tied to British government policy, not just during the postwar period, but also in the decades before. And allow me here to go slightly back in time before returning to the postwar period. Its early success depended on the government's push for the use of empire timber, or timber from imperial sources, as well as other colonial commodities in the 30s, during a period that public support for the empire was in demise. So well-known postwar campaigns led by the Empire Marketing Board, one of which we see here on the left, and special timber exhibitions across the country. On the right, we see the catalog of one of those timber exhibitions, 1928, for the Imperial Institute here in London. West African species, such as African kaya, were introduced to British consumers, as well as architects, builders, and businesses. And I think what's interesting to note here is that what is marketed here as West African mahogany was technically not West African mahogany, but a different species called kaya. So it wasn't related to Caribbean mahogany, yet it was marketed as such, and quite successfully. Moreover, the largest client of the African Timber Company, at least initially, was the British government itself. Starting in the 1930s, various government departments, railway, port and harbor authorities, and public corporations in Britain were required, if possible, to exclusively use wood from the colonies and dominions for building projects. As a result, the Office of Works, but also local authorities, such as the London County Council, had a preference for materials wholly or in part obtained from sources within the empire, for council housing projects, for example. And here we see an example of that. We see the doors of the Lambeth County Court, a building in South London, built in 1929. And these were empire timber doors. They were made from Burmese teak, for example. Where we see the most extensive use of empire timber, however, is in Britain's post offices, buildings that themselves were key nodes within a global imperial communication network. In the 1930s, when the interiors of 120 post offices in London were remodeled, most of these contained counters, screens, and paneling made of tropical timber. And I've been able to detect that at least 11 new branches in London had African mahogany, such as the one in Clapham Common upstairs, and then also the one at Euston Road. So all the wood you see is empire timber, African mahogany. All of these no longer exist. So in some of these post office, the timber was labeled so that clients who would come in would see that this was actually empire timber. And I haven't been able to detect or find an example of that here in London, but we did find an example of that when we went to Ghana 2 weeks ago. So here, the post office in Sekondi, it still had these little labels. The wood itself has been painted over, so it's now blue. But before it was painted blue, that was once Makore, and on the right, I think it's African walnut, and also detailing where for what it was used. In the decades after World War II, even though the term empire timber was gradually replaced by the more detached and neutral phrase world woods, the use of West African timber flourished. In fact, it was World War II itself, and more specifically, the severe timber shortages that brought tropical timber into lower and middle class British interiors. One of the main uses of West African timber in the 1940s was for the design of utility furniture. The simple, functional, and modern tables, chairs, beds, and cabinets distributed by the government or the state during World War II, during a period of great scarcity. Although often assumed to be manufactured out of homegrown oak, most designs were actually available in two versions, oak and, for slightly more money, in mahogany, most of which came from Africa. So for example, the designs here on the bottom were in mahogany and on the top from oak. And this is one of these moments, I think, where perhaps the post-war started slightly, or the timeline doesn't quite add up, it starts slightly earlier. In the years thereafter, if we look at some of Britain's most canonical architectural projects, we see tropical timber, although its abundant use has been overshadowed in the literature by a persistent focus on materials were commonly associated with the post-war modern, such as concrete, steel, and aluminum. But one only has to consider the iconic designs for the Festival of Britain, held in 1951 on London South Bank, a festival that offered a tonic to the nation, an optimistic, technologically infused vision of what the future had to offer. While some of the entry arches, which we see here, entering the festival site from Waterloo Station, were made of Douglas fir, a gift from the Dominion of Canada, the better known and still visible examples are in Royal Festival Hall. So that's the building we see here on the left, photo by Nigel Henderson, and the interior of Royal Festival Hall on the right. Its timber paneled auditorium consisted of West African Gaboon plywood, while Queensland walnut from Australia was used for the doors, with teak, most likely from Burma, and mohimbi from either Kenya or Uganda for the flooring. Even though there was little space for Britain's colonies within the exhibition, and the exhibition poster seemed to suggest that modern Britain was once again an island separated from its vast yet rapidly crumbling empire, the materials tell a different story. Royal Festival Halls, in some ways, was perhaps a microcosm of British post-war modernity, a type of modernism that came into being in a world that was still defined by colonialism, financed by imperial extraction, and in a very literal sense, made possible by the extraction of imperial materials. Other projects associated with the welfare state, such as universities, sport facilities, and civic centers, also relied upon tropical timbers. One could think of, for example, Basil Spence's building for Nottingham University, seen here on the left, containing African mahogany flooring. And we know that the mahogany for this came from Sepehle and Somerboy, or the yellow, gold, and Morocco ceilings of the Royal Commonwealth Pool in Edinburgh of the late 60s. In many of these instances, architects used tropical timber in juxtaposition with materials such as concrete, glass, or steel. If the creation of the welfare state helped soften the harsh realities of life in post-war Britain, then perhaps tropical timber helped temper the austere aesthetic qualities of modernism associated with the post-war welfare state. Yet, ubiquity did not equal visibility. Rather, one could argue that the proliferation of tropical timber went hand in hand with its imperceptibility. Many other uses of tropical timber, especially as import became more and more affordable, were less iconic and increasingly mundane. Tropical plywood was, for example, widely used for purposes such as seating in football stadiums, such as here in Hull City, or temporary office spaces, toilet units, camping reception rooms, or even fences. Although increasingly invisible to its many users, West African timber also dotted Britain's coastlines as shuttering, its landscapes as fences seen here, and cities as scaffolding. And this image always makes me a little bit sad. While wrapping up, I'd like to come back to United Africa House in London for a brief moment. It opened, as I mentioned earlier, in 1960, the beginning of Britain's swinging 60s, but also, of course, the year of Nigeria's independence, following Ghana's independence 3 years earlier. The abundant use of tropical timber in United Africa House was not intended as the company's swan song. Rather, what we see here is a company in full force, a company that had been planning for independence, plying the new post-war, post-colonial governments with gifts while participating actively in events that celebrated Ghana's and Nigeria's future. So here we see one of these advertisements, you know, showing what the United Africa Company could do for post-colonial Nigeria. And Kwame Nkrumah, of course, famously called this a form of neo-imperialism, all these British companies that stayed on after colonialism. So rather than being a moment of great change, it was a moment of continuity, even opportunity for many British businesses, as historians like Sarah Stockwell have argued. And in doing so, they targeted a new different market, an emerging middle-class West African audience. To put it more bluntly, decolonization was a business opportunity. One product launched in the mid-60s exemplified this new focus, a modern prefabricated timber bungalow called the African Timber and Plywood System, seen here on the photograph on the right, sold in this case to a well-dressed middle-class Nigerian lady. Having extracted materials for decades, the company now sold the British idea of architectural modernity, yet made of local materials, back to the former colonies. Evelinda Mead argued in her account of grey postwar Britain that colour was never just colour, but conveyed notions of power and even racism in a time of increased migration from the colonies, then I would argue that materials were never just materials. Logged, sawn, and processed through cheap black labor, these were the materials used to help construct a country that strove toward offering free healthcare, education, and other services, and was rooted, at least in theory, in principles of equality. Thank you.
Yeah, okay. Thank you so much. Should we sit here and just try it? Well, thank you so much, Rixt and Iain, for your really, really wonderful papers. And I think what was particularly helpful for me is that I started with a bunch of questions that I had for Iain, and then I just watched them being systematically answered by your paper, which is fantastic, actually, because it really goes to show the sort of the collaborative way that you're working together as well. So I have a few questions, but I wondered if anyone else in the audience has questions, and then I'll come back. I will save my spot for the questions, though, because Mikael and then.
Hi, thank you so much for both of your talks. One of the things I was struck by again and again is the prevalence kind of underneath when listing where your archival materials from is the presence of port sunlight as a repository. And both of you were talking about the design of spaces for workers, whether that was in Britain, you know, kind of the importing of West African materials, or in West Africa, for there was an image of a Lever Brothers building. And I was wondering if you could talk about whether you see a relationship, or if you don't see any relationship, between that kind of building of a utopian worker space in port sunlight and then taking that or not taking that to the spaces in West Africa.
Should I go first? Yeah. Thank you. That's a really, I think that's a really interesting and good question. I mean, perhaps for those who don't know Port Sunlight, or for the non-British speakers, Port Sunlight is a workers' village outside of Liverpool, built for the what used to be the former headquarters of the Unilever or the Lever Brothers factory. It's quite utopian lawns, bowling lawns, lots of interesting architecture. And for me, what's really striking is that contrast, right, between sort of the utopian quality of Port Sunlight. I mean, even though one could say that it was quite restricted in ways, versus some of the workers' housing that we've seen. So we've just visited Summerboy. It was really interesting because so much of the original plan was still there and still preserved, including the factory, the bridge bungalows, but also some of the workers' housing. And I think what's also interesting about that is that we've been able to find in the archive of the United Africa Company, lots of photographs of the factory, of the bridge bungalows, but the workers' housing itself has been completely left out. And I think that also says something about sort of the thinking that went into them, or rather what didn't go into it. It's quite basic. There are different typologies, which in and of itself is interesting, also typologies that we haven't seen anywhere else in Ghana. But a lot of them were very simple barracks, so really rudimentary housing. And some of that, which is quite interesting, was actually built from timber later on. So one of the few buildings that was actually built from a local building material rather than imported from Britain.
Yeah, Lord Leverhulme, he had this utopian vision, and he saw himself as an aggressive employer. And in some ways he was, in other ways he wasn't. He created a town in Congo called Leverville, which we're going to go and visit and see. It's not a tropicalized Port Sunlight. It's very much a worker's town, very crude, basic architecture like Rixt has just described. And then Lever did visit West Africa, and he did design African houses. He drew up some plans himself for a town called Burutu, which was one of the UAC's major ports in Nigeria. So we do know the kind of housing he wanted. He designed a house for a single African worker, an educated African worker, and a married African worker. So he was still thinking about kind of categorization of the labor force. So yeah, it's fascinating to look at.
I've got a question really for Iain. I spent a bit of time at Akamota School, going in the footsteps of Michael Cardew, and there seemed this tension. There was a kind of sense of guilt about the aesthetics that have been visited on Gold Coast, Ghana, corrugated iron roofs, and that this was going to be put right at the West African Institute, that this Bauhaus. But mixed in was a sort of arts and crafts backwardness that kind of confused the situation hugely, especially in the personality of Michael Cardew, who then relocated to carry these ideas forward in Nigeria, including ideas about kind of using vernacular architecture as opposed to modernist architecture. In his pottery training center at Abuja. Whereas the trading companies, particularly Leventis, seem to really answer the needs of everyday life in a much more, you know, for example, the whole music industry in Ghana, which was so rich, was kind of made possible by Leventis, whereas there's a kind of gradualism or a sort of glamour of backwardness about the more official interventions. So in my mind, the trading companies came to seem, you know, very productive and forward-looking. I mean, the whole Akimota, it's significant that Nkrumah, who rather disliked Akimota, although he trained as a teacher there, so he kind of downgraded it. Yeah, that's really...
Well, thanks for that. I'd love to speak to you more about your experiences over there. And yeah, I think that's how I'm seeing it as well from the vantage point of the UAC archive. And I should stress as well, I think Rixt did, that we're very much viewing West Africa through the UAC archive. And therefore we're getting a very particular vantage point, and we're aware of that. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I was going to ask a question exactly about that last point you made, Iain, about the problems as well as the advantages of being embedded in the way that you talk about being embedded in that archive. I mean, famously, embedded journalists become, however much they want to offer a kind of critical commentary on the battalion or the squadron that they're part of, they end up finding a certain kind of camaraderie with and bonding with the narratives they find there. And I wonder whether how you've both dealt with that issue of being embedded in the project and making sure that the account that you give is not too celebratory or too... it's not one that ultimately ventriloquizes the kind of narratives of the company itself.
Can I add something to that before? Thank you for asking most of my question. I was also curious about whether Unilever now, because you're how open are they to critique, and also Leverhulme, is that a connection? Sort of, what does that mean? And so sort of all of these difficult questions.
Rixt, do you want to start from your perspective, or do you want me to?
Yes, I can start. It's an issue that we've spent a lot of time thinking about and talking about. And we just before we started, we had a conversation about this again, relating to the book and how to structure the book that's going to come out of it, and making sure that it shows multiple perspectives and not just the perspective from the archive.
So first of all, I would say that even though the project is in collaboration with Unilever and we're using their archive, they're not having any say about what we write or what we do. So, I mean, it is very much a critical history of the United Africa Company. And I don't think it, by any means we're trying to glorify what they've done, so rather the opposite. And really trying to shine some light on sort of the extent to which they really had an impact on West Africa through this project. And also sort of trying to show the archive, which is quite incredible, also its photographic collections, and making that public, which would be really helpful and useful.
Yeah, it's an amazing archive. It's a kilometer in length in terms of the linear meterage. It's just bigger than some of the national archives that you might find in parts of Africa. So there isn't a repository like that anywhere else. This is a particular view of the British Empire at that moment through the mercantile industries, and the UAC is huge. So within the archive is the Royal Niger Company collection, which was a company that basically founded and set out at the boundaries of modern Nigeria. That's within there. And they ran as a little country almost, including they had their own army, they had their own wars and battles, and all that's within the archive. It doesn't feature in the same way. There aren't any photographs of it. There are certain silences within the archive which are very apparent. But all these moments are documented and carefully preserved. So if you do a bit of work in the archive and then extract some of the information and extrapolate some of the facts and dates, you can piece together a much richer narrative, and that's what we're trying to do. It's not a celebratory piece of work. It's a very critical piece of work, actually. And Unilever have been very good about that. So Claire Tunstall is a collaborator in the project. She's the global arts and archivist for Unilever. She works with us. We have complete access to any part of the archive. We don't even have to ask for the archivist to retrieve the material. We can go into the storerooms and look at anything at any point, which I think is a credit to Unilever to be quite brave to do that and to take that risk. And yes, it's funded by Leverhulme. So Leverhulme's money funded Rick's salary and the project and our field work. So it's very problematic. And the building which I work, the Liverpool School of Architecture, it's called the Leverhulme Building. Lord Leverhulme paid for the Liverpool School of Architecture and the Liverpool School of Tropical Medicine and many other institutions in Liverpool. Highly problematic, but we've got to do this work now, and I think it's really important. And just one final comment, we don't want to write about Africa without the African voice coming through. We reject the about us without us approach, and because of that we're collaborating with scholars at Kumasi, University of Lagos and University of Ghana, and we're going to do an exhibition which will be based in West Africa before it comes back to Europe.
And briefly to add to that, also to perhaps counter part of the archive by doing interviews, for example, with former employees. So hopefully being able to highlight some other voices to let them come through.
Can I just ask a quick question around this kind of going back to Africa? And I think it follows a little bit on what you were asking as well. I think I'm very curious about tensions because and sort of the relationship between nationalism sort of art schools and the cooperation, because I could see that there are quite a lot of things happening, and there is of course the sort of imperial narrative, but I'm very curious about what is bubbling under the surface, or what is maybe not so much under the surface, and that's actually, you know, moments where you really see sort of anti-colonial resistance come through, especially around the arts, within this kind of broader sphere.
Well, yeah, these are the very tricky things to draw out, and there's often a tendency to polarize or to reduce things down to simple interpretations, and that's something I'm trying to counter and to present a much more delicate and nuanced wandering through, because even the UAC could respond in quite progressive ways sometimes. But most of the time, it didn't care about politics. It only cared about its shareholders and profit.
and that comes through quite clearly. And then there's a colonial office. So the, when war broke out, for example, World War II, the UAC approached the British government and said, all of our resources are at your disposal. You can use our ships, you can use our stores, you can use our people. And the British government replied by saying, we don't want to look a gift horse in the mouth, but really we do. We don't trust them. We don't trust their monopoly. We don't want to engage with them. And the UAC was funding projects like Achimota or the University of Ibadan or various community centres. It was always trying to weave its way in as well to culture and to present itself as a kind of enlightened employer. And at the same time, there was riots. So the UAC headquarters called Swanmill was burned down just after the war when the West African soldiers returned, having fought for the British Army. There was mass riots over access to goods and salaries and housing. And the UAC was seen as equivalent to the government in that sense.
And I think what you really see is that there, or what was revealing for me going through the archive, is that you really see that they're planning for independence, right? So they, years before Ghana actually becomes independent in 57, they begin to hire more African managers, which is a policy called Africanization, which other British companies also had to follow. They started training courses, at least sort of in order to, which really was to enable to continue to be there after independence. Right?
Yeah, I mean, I'm just constantly drawing parallels to India as well, because where so much of the cultural nationalism is also embedded in very colonial sort of institutions. So it's quite interesting that there can just never be a very clean break between this is imperial and this is anti-colonial sometimes, but especially in the arts.
I think where India was trying to harvest salt or spin their own cloth, that wasn't the case in West Africa. They tried in some ways, but it wasn't a major political agenda in the same way it was in the Indian context.
Where do you think architecture fits into like modern decolonial movements? Like when we think about efforts to like decolonize and address colonial legacies, is it just like shedding light on histories of colonialism, or like how can architecture be a part of the actual decolonial movement without, say, like tearing down buildings that may have like exploited African labor? Like what is architecture's role?
Rixt?
I think that's a really important question, and obviously a difficult one to answer. So something that we've been talking about and thinking about as well is obviously what to do with a lot of these structures now, a lot of which are in disrepair, crumbling down. Should they be preserved? Should they not be preserved? One way in which I think architecture can play a really important role is sort of by adding context to these buildings, which can be done in multiple ways, right? But also could be done online, for example. So we're trying to organize an exhibition as well, which will travel a short photo book with some of the photographs from the archive, but also from today, which can be distributed and is very accessible, and also making these stories more accessible. I think that's one of the ways of doing that.
Yeah, I think it brings up ideas about meaning and symbolism, and even things like integrity and authenticity and have higher values. So I think what becomes important is it who designed the building, who owned the building, or where it is. I think they're all important, but I also think architectural meaning is very fluid and can often be changed and readapted, and it can symbolize something else. I mean, New Delhi is a huge example of colonial project, and it's still there and it's viewed in a different way now. I think what the difference is in West Africa and in Ghana in particular is that there are many colonial buildings, but no one knows the history, no one knows who owned them. There's a kind of certain amnesia to the buildings. They persist. They continue, they're there, they're used in different ways or not, but no one has an architectural understanding of their history. I think it's really important. That's got to be set out, because we can't possibly begin to understand and recognize value or not if we don't know anything about who owned it and made it and why. That's kind of my project, really. Well, that's what I want to do for the next 10 years.
This question from Inga Fraser, submitted online, which perhaps kind of picks up on this a little bit. It's for both speakers. You've mentioned a handful of the artists engaged by the UAC for various projects, such as Kofi Yandubin, Iain, and some of the pre-war structures, which frequently engaged artists, Rixt, such as Empire Marketing Board. I wonder whether you could say more about artists and their projects commissioned as part of architectural projects in Britain and Africa by the UAC post-war. So it's a question about if you could say more about the visual artists who were engaged.
Okay, yeah, I think it's a really important question. I mean, in some ways there was a move in post-war Britain to allocate a percentage of a construction project cost to including art and sculpture. So sometimes it was as much as 1% of the building costs would be spent on commissioning a piece of artwork. And the architects, or a lot of the British architects that were working in Ghana at the time, like Fry and Drew, were very much committed to that, and they wanted to collaborate with people like Kofi Antamabam and many others. And there's examples that I showed in the Nigerian international office, which was full of African sculpture and large murals and motifs and so on. And I think that became in part about softening the modernism a little bit, trying to contextualize it, trying to add a certain sense of the local. But I think it was more than that. I think they saw it as an integral to it. I don't think they could think about designing a building without there being an element of didactic storytelling in some way. And I think that's why it was often quite figurative. I think the buildings were designed to be read almost. I think they were seen as large texts. The UAC was happy to be sponsoring and funding these artworks, but they weren't the drivers. It was very much the architects, like Fry and Drew, Cubitt, Kenneth Scott, Nixon and Boris, that were really pushing for this.
And I think the other part to that is what is now left in the UAC archive itself, and also the Unilever collections, which still has a vast amount of artworks and also gifts given from people they worked with, they traded with. There's an incredible piece of wood, gigantic, which is now in the Unilever archive. No one ever sees it. It doesn't come out. It's an incredible piece by, I think it's a Nigerian artist, which was given to the UAC. But hopefully something will be done with that.
Well, firstly, thank you. This is a really fascinating look, and I think it sets some pointers also for art history and thinking about, you know, looking at histories in this wider network of commissioning and power beyond the aesthetic and its own sort of domain. Picking up that trend, I wanted to ask sort of two questions. One, this focus on the mercantile. Now, and looking at China and its sort of mercantile imperialism, if we were to call it that within quote marks, what comparisons, differences do you see, or is that part and parcel or a part of what you're looking at? The second question was really just a response to something you just said, Iain, which was this idea that these are things to be read, but people don't read them. You know, the buildings that are there in West Africa, and was struck by the parallel between public monuments and sculptures that also kind of appear and were quite often sort of subscribed and then are forgotten, and we walk past them, and you know, they're largely mute, but carry meaning. And I wonder if that's a comparison that is fruitful.
So let me respond to your first question, and then I'm going to let Iain respond to maybe both of them. That's actually a really interesting point, which we haven't really thought about. What I would say is that there is an architectural historian named Cole Roskam, who has written quite extensively about China's increasing sort of breadth in different parts of Africa and what has come out of that. So if this is something that interests you, that might perhaps be interesting. I think in terms of comparison, maybe this is something we can only establish in a couple of decades, sort of to see whether we can really, to see after some of these big Chinese projects that have come out, sort of can see what the impact of them is when they've been completed, what the workers' housing built for these projects is, etc. So perhaps it needs a bit more time to fully see the extent of China's investment in Africa to make a comparison like that.
Yeah, it's a great question, because the Chinese presence in West Africa is growing all the time. You can now start to see the tangible impact. So in the fishing harbour in Accra, for example, that's now been, the beach has been cleared and it's been demolished, and they're building a Chinese-sponsored fishing factory there. It's going to have a dramatic impact on the landscape, and something I've been documenting over the years. When you're driving through parts of quite remote parts of Ghana now, where there's mining and mineral extraction, you'll see a lot of Chinese characters and signage on quite small shops. So they're obviously selling to Chinese workers who are based on these forest and mining centres. So that it's starting to change, and I think it is a kind of imperialism. I don't think it's, I know it's a difficult word to use, but I think it is. And I think it needs to be looked at and researched very carefully for obvious reasons. And then in terms of the monuments and the muteness, I think that happens over time to all monuments. They become less relevant and containing less meaning sometimes. And that's definitely happened both with the nationalist projects in Ghana, like Black Star Square, for example. It's now a huge parade ground, which is rarely used. Maybe the kind of triumphal arch with the black star on doesn't contain the same amount of meaning. It's now effectively a roundabout. And there's some old British monuments, like an obelisk celebrating the Ashanti War from 1900 in Accra. And a market's been built around it, and it's now been kind of subsumed and lost within the market, and only just recently excavated again as this market's been refurbished. So it's kind of an archaeology taking place. So yeah, I think that's great thing to look at, and there's certainly lots more research that has to happen on that. Thank you. There's a question at the back.
Thank you. I would question your example of Festival Hall as I had the privilege of talking to the architect, and essentially the wood is incidental to the building. The building's essentially concrete glass, in often used in innovative ways. So I'm not sure that your example really stands as an exemplar of the use of wood. And on the question of the continuities, which you highlighted, well, I agree with that. And your latest answer from Iain, I think is the fact that basically colonialism never went away, and independence was in many instances a sham. It was replaced by multinational colonialism and now Chinese colonialism. So when you gave the example of steel being imported from Britain, well, a country without a steel factory cannot really be independent. And the continuities as well are reflected in the fact that comprador bourgeoisies just continued, and these patterns of trade just continue regardless of independence. So I think your thesis is slightly uneven, because trade continues regardless of the governance structure or colonialism, whether it's called colonialism, independence, trade just continues. So I think you need to examine your conclusions a bit more carefully.
If I may respond to your first remark about Royal Festival Hall, what I've tried to show tonight is that even if architects like Leslie Martin or the others who worked on Royal Festival Hall did not think carefully about the type of wood they used, doesn't mean that it doesn't have any meaning. I think that's really sort of shows the point, the unintentional use of these types of materials. So the fact that a lot of architects perhaps not even thought about the fact that they used West African timber or sort of timber from anywhere else. So it really shows the ubiquity of that material. And in that sense, what I said, the imperceptibility of it, sort of its total pervasiveness from its wood being used in Royal Festival Hall to sort of a fence in a village in the Midlands. It doesn't need to be intentional wood for it to be an example of the pervasiveness of the colonial system and that system of extraction.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I think they had a choice. So Leslie Martin had a choice, didn't he? He didn't have to use wood. He could have used rubber floors, but he didn't. He chose wood. And then where does that wood come from, and why did he want to use it? And of course, it could be shaped and molded and steamed. And timbers was written out of the story of modern architecture in many ways. And what Rixt is doing, I think, successfully is weaving it back in and saying, oh, actually, it's much more central to the story of modern architecture than we previously thought. And I think that raises the question, where do you get it from, or what wood? Who's making it, who's chopping it, where are the sawmills? And it creates a totally different architectural history, not one about form, or not even about aesthetics, but about networks, processes, and the movement of materials and labor and capital. And then I don't think independence is a sham. I just think it's not done in perfect ways. And we've got to look at imperfection and how people try to do things. They often failed and they often succeeded in other ways. So you can't have you can be independent without a steel factory. And Kwame Nkrumah tried to do it by having an aluminium factory, tried to create a dam to produce electricity and then to extract bauxite and then to smelt aluminium in Ghana to be self-sustaining. And he couldn't do that entirely with his own expertise and workforce or capital necessarily, but he still achieved it. And yeah, you do have to trade. Every country has to trade, of course, but then what are the balances? Is it a fair trade? Is it a sustainable trade? And it's easy to always look at the West African city as a kind of, or West African architecture, or even governments and countries as failures, or to look at the problems of West Africa. And what we're trying to do is to say, well, yeah, there are problems. We're not going to ignore them, but also we want to try and celebrate what is good. And there's some absolutely wonderful architecture in West Africa, extraordinary works, which are often ignored. And for me, I just think we've got to look at them a little bit more carefully, and also to look for, in a way, what's beautiful in the West African city too. I really appreciate your question, and we do need to work on the conclusions. They aren't resolved, but we're midway through the project.
Hi. Great presentation, by the way. I just had a question about choice of materials that were used by the architects around the 50s and the post-war architects that were mostly European in West Africa designing buildings. And whether the choice of materials is deliberate or just, it'd be interesting whether you have any comments on that, because I think in Ghana at the moment, there's a discussion going on around sustainability and climate change and use of laterite and burnt brick and timber. But actually, when you speak to local architects, they say we can't get any timber. We can't. Most of the timber's exported still. And so the story that you were telling, which started in the 50s, it still happened today in 2022. So I'm just wondering whether, from a legacy perspective, you can comment on how choice of materials, which may have been deliberate or not, is actually impacting the current architectural scene in Ghana and West Africa in general today, in the light of the climate change issues that are all around.
I think that's a really, really important question. I'll talk into the microphone. I think that's a really important question. And I think, as you point out, sort of that the question of materials today is political in a country like Ghana. It was then as well. And it makes me think of Richard Wright, the African-American journalist, went to West Africa right before independence and interviewed Kwame Nkrumah quite extensively, wrote a nice book about it. And in it, they talk about, for example, concrete, and Nkrumah wanting to build in concrete, but saying, like, we don't have a concrete factory here. We need to import it from Britain. And that only came later. So the modern architecture that Iain talked about was mostly concrete, which was mostly imported from Britain. The buildings I showed in Summerboy, again, most of the materials were imported from Britain. However, that's not to say that there weren't experiments being done with other materials. There's another British architect who worked for the local Office of Works, public Department of Works, who experimented, for example, with rammed earth, which he tried to promote for a while as swishcrete. Right, it wasn't actually concrete, it was just rammed earth added with a tiny amount of concrete to it, and then tried to market it as such. So there were sort of interesting experiments being done at a smaller scale to sort of get around that problem of importing everything from Britain.
There was an edge as well to the use of adobe and mud. Mm-hmm. So a lot of communities, when they tried to do village housing, rejected that and said, we want cement.
Yeah.
We want concrete blocks. There was even a pitched roof with a central ridge was desired over a sloping mono pitch roof laid with corrugated iron, because a ridge was seen as desirable and aspirational. It was a proper roof. So I think it depended on who you were designing for. And the example Rixt used, this person, Alfred Alcock, was trying to celebrate local materials to save the importation costs. I think the 400,000 bags of cement per month was being imported at one point into Ghana alone. And that was stopping the importation of other goods, because that was taking up room on the ships. And therefore that contributed to inflation, which caused the economy to overheat, which made construction more expensive. So even just that choice of using concrete had major ramifications on other goods that were available and accessible to people. In terms of sustainability, this is a reason why I think we've got to understand some of these structures, because they can be reused and shouldn't be just demolished and replaced with a lot of the glass and steel structures that are now being built in Ghana. And there's some good work being done at the moment on how tropical modernism performs climatically, how comfortable people feel within a naturally ventilated structure, and whether it's necessary, in fact, to chill the interior of modern buildings to the extent that they currently are. So all the building regulations and design guides that are used in West Africa are actually based on American and European design guides, and suggesting a comfort level of 21 degrees C. Well, the research that we've been doing at Liverpool suggests that people are comfortable in buildings that are up to 28 or even 30 degrees C. So why are they trying to cool them so to such low temperatures? So I think there's quite fascinating discussions to have around material choices and how buildings are cooled, and the role of tropical modernist architecture as well.
Thank you. I have one very sort of practical question in a sense, but since we are talking about import, and I was just really quite curious about timber being brought, so much timber as well being brought to Britain, and thinking of timber as a living sort of thing, which I assume also carried other non-human species with it. And I don't know, now there's quite a lot of sort of restrictions on importing wood from different parts of the world. And yes, I think I'm just quite curious about what, if there were any repercussions in terms of like bringing wood and insects, or and whether, I mean, this is wishful thinking on my part, but whether it sort of led to some kind of, you know, a small resistance in a way, because it started something else. But yeah, I'm just curious.
Interesting. I have to think about that. Part of the wood, sort of a big change that happened in the 1940s was that they started sawing logs in Ghana, Nigeria itself. So rather than exporting sort of entire logs to Britain, they started sort of shipping they kept on shipping the sawn logs, which obviously was more much cheaper. Mm-hmm. But that also meant that the log, much of the wood was very heavily treated with anti-termite mm-hmm. Spray, etc. Mm-hmm. So probably at that point, mm-hmm. sort of very little insects mm-hmm. would have come to Britain.
Mm-hmm. I'm just quite curious about like how things travel and also sort of where things stay on and questions like
but
that.
But it was a really extensive system. So we looked at these two sites where the timber came from, but they really were part of this sort of very big infrastructural apparatus. In order to ship and process the timber, they had to build hundreds of kilometers of roads, bridges. It sometimes took weeks for those logs from the concessions to be even floated down to Summerboy and Sapele before it would be shipped mm-hmm. to Britain. Mm-hmm. So it was an enormous undertaking. And part of the story as well is that the United Africa Company had its own shipping line, mm-hmm. Palm Line, which was another subsidiary company.
Right.
Before it was brought to Liverpool or the West India docks here in London.
Yeah, last question from Mark, and then.
Thanks, Sriya. Sorry to hog a second question, but really to Rixt, I'd say both those papers were just fantastic. I think I've learned as much in three quarters of an hour for a long time as I did tonight. Rixt, and kind of following on or bouncing back of what Hamad said about what artistry might learn from the kind of work that you two are doing, but also how issues around aesthetics and form do seem to inform the kind of work you're doing with timber. And it'd be great for you to talk a bit more about the ways the aesthetics of the different kinds of wood and how they operated within the British context of the buildings that you showcase and the ways in which they were understood to work. You know, if you're in a room with mahogany, how was that mahogany being experienced or read if you're a participant in its mm-hmm. in its environment?
I think that's something that's really hard for us to sort of understand now, in part because all of the photographs of these projects we have are in black and white, which really don't show the richness and sort of the variations in colors and textures of these projects, which is why I try to add at least sort of some of the colors so you can start to see the different textures and shapes to it. But I think a project like United Africa House really shows that architects were thinking carefully about the different types and different colors of timber they used, and also thinking about them together. And if you look, there's an incredible wide range of variations of fine grains, sort of broader grains to be used. Trying to gather my thoughts. Anything to...
I'm just trying to think what art history can learn from our methodology. I haven't thought about that before. But for me, I'm not trying to write an architectural history that's about progression of form and styles. Although I am interested in obviously the shape of buildings, but for me, I think it's more about land ownership, function, power, and also biography as well, of how people and ideas travel. But I'm sure people in art history must be doing that, but I think architecture, I think because it's rooted in space and because it's responding to something bigger than the architect's ambition, perhaps, that's what draws me into it. I think that's my approach. I don't know if I've answered your question sufficiently.
If I may add to that, I think there's something scalar about the approach we have that perhaps architectural history has to offer, sort of being able, because we think about spaces at different scales. We think about the building and then we go smaller, sort of we look at the material, but also bigger because we look at it in its urban context and territorial. I think that's quite useful, especially about thinking and doing these histories of colonial architecture and also our history, to be able to sort of scale up and scale down, because in order to fully grasp sort of the extent to, for example, what the United Africa Company, what they were doing, sort of, it's, you have to be able to sort of zoom out to massive scale in order to understand the vastness. And yet also, I think to be able to zoom in, to look at a cocktail cabinet in United Africa House, and think like, okay, this is sort of through these different steps, sort of can be traced back to a mahogany tree in Western Ghana.
And I think we're even drawing from geography more as well, in terms of like the approach of David Harvey, Doreen Massey, rather than art history, I would say.
On that note, I really just want to say thanks to both Iain and Rixt for, in some sense, also closing the series with such a rich conversation. So thank you. Thanks to all of you, both in person and online, for coming to this event, but also other events in the series. And we look forward to, well, at the moment, look forward to a reception next door and then having you back in the center and online for future events. So thank you.